In the previous class, we are discussing the simplified instructional computer machine architecture with respect to memory, registers, data formats, instruction formats, instruction set, input and output, okay, and the simplified instructional computer programming examples. Let me refresh these things quickly. Okay. So what is the memory in SIC? Memory consists of 8-bit bytes. Okay, there is a total of 32 kilobytes of memory. Okay, and all addresses are byte addressable. That means at each address there is a byte, and any three consecutive bytes form a word. Three consecutive bytes means 24 bit form a word. Okay. And coming to the registers, it has five registers: register A, register B. Sorry, register A, register X, and then register L, and register PC, and register SW. Okay, and all registers are 24 bit in length. And then the data formats. So how the data is encoded in memory in simplified instruction computer? So integers are stored as 24 bit binary numbers. 2's complement representation is used for negative values. Characters are stored using 8-bit ASCII codes, and there is no floating point hardware on the standard version of the SIC machine. Okay. So it does not support the floating point number. Okay. And then the instruction format. So what do you mean by machine instruction? Machine instruction has an opcode, that is operation code, and the operand. And all the machine instructions on standard version of SIC have the 24-bit format. So all machine instructions have the 24-bit format. Okay, so the first 8 bits are reserved for opcode, and the next bit is reserved for the flag bit X, which is used to indicate the addressing mode. And then the next 15 bit is reserved for the address, okay, which indicates the position of the operand in memory. Then coming to the addressing modes on standard version of SIC. What do you mean by addressing mode? The different ways by which you can access the data stored in register or memory. Okay. So standard version of SIC has 2 addressing modes. Okay. Which are indicated by setting the flag bit X. If X is equal to 0, it is direct addressing. And if X is equal to 1, then it is indexed addressing. Okay. In direct addressing, how the target address is calculated? Target address is equal to simply the address. Okay. And in indexed addressing, the target address is equal to the address plus the content of the index register. And then coming to the instruction set, standard version of SIC has the load and store instructions such as LDA, LDX, STA, STX, and so on. And there are integer arithmetic instructions such as add, sub, mul, okay? And then a comparison instruction such as a COMP, and then conditional jump instruction such as JLE, jump if, JLT, jump if less than, and then JEQ, jump if equal, JGT, jump if greater than. And then there are subroutine linkage instructions, J sub, R sub, okay, and so on. Okay. And how the input and output is performed on standard version of SIC? Input and output is performed by transferring 1 byte of data to or from the rightmost 8 bits of the register A. And there are IO instructions such as TD for test device. Okay. and the RD stands for read data, and then the instruction WD okay stands for write data. And then we have come across the SICK assembler directives that are useful while programming the simplified instructional computer. Okay, so which are the SICK assembler directives? They are just pseudo instructions. They are just instructions to the assembler. So we have start, which defines the program starting address. Then we have end, indicate the end program. Then we have byte, which is used to generate character or hexadecimal constant using the required number of bytes. Then we have the word that is used to generate one word constant. And then we have RESB, stands for reserve bytes. It is used to reserve bytes for a data area. And then RESW, which is used to reserve word for data area. And we are discussing simple examples of simplified instructional computer assembly language programming. Okay, and these examples include sample data movement operations on the simplified instructional computer, and then these sample arithmetic operation on standard version of the SICK machine. So today, let us continue with the simplified instructional computer programming example. And then after that, we'll again see the SICK bar XE machine architecture, okay, which is another version of the SICK machine, SICK bar XE. And then if time permits, we'll see the SICK bar XE programming examples also. Yeah, so let us continue with a few more SICK programming example. So another example. So this example shows the demonstration of looping and indexing operation on the SICK. So in this example, what we'll do, we'll write a sequence of instructions for the simplified instructional computer that copies a 11-byte character string to another string. Okay, we'll copy one string to another. So how to copy one string to another? Here is the logic, okay? How do you do the data declaration and initialization? All the data and declarations are done at the bottom of the program, okay? So you have a string variable str1, okay? That is initialized with a 11-byte character string. So the character string initialized is a test string, which is 11 byte. Okay. And how do you declare and initialize a 11 byte character string? Using the byte assembler directive. Okay, use the byte assembler directive. Okay, then string one is a 11 byte character constant. So what we'll do, we want to copy this string to another string, say str2. Okay, then str2 is how many byte variable? So it is 11 byte variable. Okay, so you have to copy exactly 11 byte now, then str2 is a 11 byte variable. Then how do you declare it? So using RESB, so reserve byte. Okay, so then str2 is a 11 byte variable. So you will copy string one into the string two, byte by byte. Okay. So since, as you know, that the string is nothing but a character array, okay, in order to process the character array, you need to have an array index, isn't it? And as you all know, that the array index begins with zero. Okay. Then you will use some register to initialize the array index, okay? Which is that register? The register X, say. Since register X is used for addressing, no? Then use the register X for index, to store the index value, okay? And how do you store the value 0 into the register X? You have to use the LDX instruction, So load into register X, value 0. Then what is this 0? Apparent 0. Okay, it is a one word constant initialized with 0. See here at the bottom. Okay, so 0 is a one word constant. Okay, the name of the variable is 0. Okay, so give some meaningful name. Okay, because since index value you want to initialize with 0, so the variable name is 0. And how do you generate one word constant? So 0 is nothing but a constant, no? So you have to use the assembler directive word. So word is used to generate one word constant. And what is that one word constant? It is 0, the value 0. Okay. Now index register is initialized with the value 0. Okay. Then start copying each byte from string str1 into str2. So how do you do that? Since you have to copy the string character by character or byte by byte, okay, so what you have to do, okay, in order to perform the data movement operation on the strings, no, you have to use the LDCH and STCH instructions. So LDCH stands for load character into the register A, at most 8 bit of register A. And STS stand for store the character from the register A into some memory location. Here it is STR2, okay? So like that. So using LDCH instruction, we'll first, in the first loop, we'll copy the first byte of the string STR1 into the register A, okay? Now see the operand here, STR1 comma X, because the target address is nothing but this STR1 plus the content of the register X. This X holds the array index value. Okay. So first byte from this memory location, that means str1 plus content of X is retrieved. Okay. And it is loaded into the register A. Okay. So from register A, now the byte is in register A. From register A, you have to store it into the first byte of the string str2. Okay. So how to do that? Using STCH instruction. Okay, store the character in register A into this, the first byte of the str2 variable. Okay. Again, what is the target address of the first byte? Okay, again, target address is equal to address of str2 plus the content of the index register, which holds the index value. Okay. Then check whether you have copied all the 11 bytes. Okay, no, you have not copied all the 11 bytes still. How do you compare that? Okay. So you'll use a instruction called TIX, okay? So this TIX instruction performs two functions, okay? So what are these two functions? It first add one to the index, that means to the index register, okay? Index value is stored in index register, as you know. It add one to the index, that means index register, and then it compare the new value of the index register with its operand, okay? So here the operand is 11. 11 is nothing but you have to copy the 11 bytes, no? So then you need to have one word constant, okay? Which is initialized with value 11, okay? See here at the bottom, data declaration statement. 11 is nothing but a one word constant. How to generate it? Using the word assembler directive, okay? And what is the value? 11, okay? So this TX instructions adds one to the index register, okay? So in order to point to the next byte of the str1 and str2, okay? So it compares the new value of register X with this operand 11, okay? So it has the value 11, okay? Then it sets the condition code, okay? According to the results of the comparison, okay? Then you need to test the condition code. How do you test the condition code? Use the JLT instruction, jump if less than, okay? That means if the new value in register X is less than 11, that means you have not copied all the 11 bytes, okay? Still, you have the bytes to copy, okay? So then jump to this loop, okay? So the loop label is moves CH, okay? So label you have to give to this LDCH instruction. Again, copy the next byte from str1 and then store it into str2, okay? And this is repeated, this loop is repeated till all the 11 bytes are copied to str2. Okay. So this is how you perform looping and indexing operations on standard version of the SICK machine. So any doubts here, students? Any doubts?
No, sir.
Have you understood?
No, sir.
Yeah. So next, how to perform sample input-output operations on the standard version of the simplified instructional computer. Okay. So here is an example. So in this example, what we'll do, we'll try to read a 1 byte of data from an input device, okay, and store it in a 1 byte variable. And then later, we'll load the value of 1 byte of data stored in the variable into the output device. That means we'll write the value stored in this 1 byte variable into the output device. So as you know that how the input and output operations are performed on standard version of SICK, it is performed by transferring 1 byte of data at a time, okay, to or from the rightmost 8 bits of the register A. Okay. So before transferring the data, okay, we need to test the device, okay, input device or output device. Okay, how do you test the input or output device? Using the test device instruction, okay, that is TD instruction. Okay, so only when the address device is ready, then only you can perform read and write data operations. Okay, so first what we'll do is we'll use the test device instruction to test whether the input device is ready to send the data. Okay. And as you know that each device is assigned a unique 8-bit code, okay? That is used as an operand to the IO instruction here, okay? So test device, and what is the operand? The device number is an operand, okay? So what is that device number? Says in device, okay? Some name, okay? Of the variable name, okay? So you declare this at the bottom, okay? So input device, INDEV stands for input device, okay? And this input device is, as I said, it is an 8-bit code, okay, or 8-bit number, hexadecimal number, okay. Then you need to generate an hexadecimal constant, okay. So how do you generate an hexadecimal constant? Use the byte directive. Byte directive is used to generate, as I said, character or hexadecimal constant. So input device is a variable, okay, which holds the hexadecimal value F1. Okay. How do you indicate that it is an hexadecimal constant? Okay, so prefix the letter X, okay, with this value, okay. Then F1 is an hexadecimal constant. X indicates it is an hexadecimal constant, okay. So INDEV will now have the input device number, okay. So test the input device, okay. Check whether it is ready to send the data, okay. And this test device now, after executing, will set the condition code, okay, in order to indicate the result of the test, okay. If the condition code is set to less than, that means the device is ready to send the data, okay. If the condition code is set to equals, okay, that means the device is not ready, okay. Then you have to be in loop, okay, until the device is ready, okay. So after executing test device instruction, you execute jump if equal instruction to check whether the device is ready. Okay, so you, if the condition code is set to equals, then be in a loop. Okay, simply test the device. Okay, it will be in loop. Okay. Loop until device is ready. Okay, so once the device is ready, when the device will be ready, when the condition code is set to equals. Okay, then the device is ready. Okay, so then you perform the read operation. How do you perform the read operation on the input device? Use the RD instruction, okay? Read data instruction, okay? So it will read the 1 byte of data from this input device number, okay? Pass the device number as operand to this RD, okay? Which is stored in this variable, okay? In device, okay? So, and the red data will be stored in the rightmost 8 bit of register A. Okay, so this add instruction will read 1 byte into register A. Okay, now the data red will be in the register A. From register A, we want to store it in a 1 byte variable called data. Okay, so data is a 1 byte variable. Then how do you reserve space for 1 byte variable? Use RESB instruction, reserve byte. How many byte you want to reserve? 1 byte. So data is a 1 byte variable. Okay, so then how do you store 1 byte of data in register A into this 1 byte variable? Use STH instruction, store the 1 byte data, that means character, in register A into this 1 byte variable. Okay, so now the 1 byte of data read from the input device is stored in this variable, okay, 1 byte variable data. So now in the next sequence of instruction, what we'll do, so the data stored in this 1 byte variable, we'll write it onto the output device. Okay, so these are the sequence of instructions. Okay, again we are writing 1 byte of data to the output device. Again, before writing the data to the output device, you have to test the device, okay, to check whether the address device is ready to receive the data. Okay, so again use the test device instruction, test the device. Which device? Pass the device number as an operand. So out, the DEV is nothing but stands for output device. Okay, and so this will store the device number. So what is the, how do you store, declare the device number? Again, use the assembly directive byte. Okay, and what is its value? The device number. Okay, so what is the device number? 05. Okay, how do you indicate that it is a hexadecimal constant? The device number is a hexadecimal constant. You prefix the value with X. X indicate it is a hexadecimal number or constant. Okay, then is this output device is a output device number. Okay, then after executing test device instruction, okay, condition is code is test, condition code is set. Okay, then you check the condition code. Okay, using the conditional jump instruction. Which instruction? Jump if equal. Okay, if the condition code is set to equal, that means the device is not ready. Then you have to loop until device is ready. Jump if equal, outer loop. Okay, so we'll come here again. Test, we will execute the test device. It will be in loop. Okay, and suppose if the condition code is set to equals, then the device is ready. Output device ready to receive the data. Okay, now you have to load the 1 byte of data in this 1 word variable into register A. Then from register A, you have to write it into the output device. Okay, so what are these instructions? Okay, so load into the rightmost 8 bit of register A, the 1 byte of data stored in this 1 byte variable. Okay, so then 1 byte of data stored in this 1 byte variable will be loaded into register A. Okay, so then from register A, we'll write it onto the output device. How? By using the WD instruction. What this WD instruction stand for? Write data. Okay, so this write data instruction will write the 1 byte of data in register A into the output device. Okay. Yeah, so this is how we perform input output operations on the standard version of the SICK machine. Any doubt here?
No, sir.
No. Anybody, any doubts?
No, sir.
So then that is about the standard version of SICK. Okay. And then another version of SICK is SICK bar XE. Okay. XE stands for extra equipment or extra expensive. Okay. So let us discuss the architecture of the SICK bar XE machine again with respect to memory, registers, data formats, instruction format, the instruction set, and the input and addressing modes, and then the input and output. Okay, as I said, the machine architecture differs in memory, okay, the registers, the number and type of the registers, the okay, data formats, instruction set, okay, addressing modes, and the input and output. Okay, so what is memory in SICK bar XE machine architecture? Okay, So again, as in standard version of SIGNO, again, memory consists of 8-bit bytes. That means at each address, there is a byte. Okay. And all addresses are byte addresses. At each address, there is a byte. Okay. And this SIGBAR-XC machine could access 1 megabyte of memory. Okay. Whereas the standard version of SIG could access only 32 kilobytes of memory. Okay. See the increase in memory here. Okay. So what is the width of the address bus then? 20 bits. Okay. Then how do you calculate the memory capacity? 2 to the power of 20 bytes. Okay. The formula is 2 to the power of n, where n is the width of the address bus. 2 to the power of 20 bytes is nothing but 1 megabyte. Okay. So obviously it has an 20-bit address bus. So an address 20 bit cannot be fitted into a 15-bit field as in SIG standard. Okay. That means standard version of SIG has 15-bit address. Okay, 15-bit address bus. So obviously an address of 20 bits cannot fit it into 15-bit field as in the SIG standard. Okay. And must change instruction formats and addressing modes. That means the increase in the memory leads to change in instruction format and the addressing modes. Again, as in standard version of SIG, any 3 consecutive bytes form a word. Okay, word means 24-bit. Then coming to the registers. So all the registers available on standard version of SIG is also available to the SIGBAR-XC machine. Okay, like register A, register X, register L, okay, register PC and register SW. Okay, so in addition to that, there are some additional registers provided by SIGBAR-XC. So which are those? Register B, register S, register T and register F. Okay, and the number is given only for reference. Okay. And what are its uses? Register B is used as the base register. Okay, it is used for addressing, like your register X. And register S and T, they are used as a general working register. Okay, there is no special use of these registers. They are just used as general working register. Okay, and the SIGBAR-XC machine supports the floating point number. Okay, there is a floating point hardware and the SIGBAR-XC machine. Okay, so then register F. Okay, it is used for floating point accumulator. Okay, if you want to perform some floating point operation, you can use this floating point accumulator register, okay, which is 48 bits. Okay, and other registers are 24 bit in length. Okay, only the register F is 48 bits, and the register B, S, T are 24 bit in length. Okay. That means they can store 24 bit of data. 3 byte. 24 bit means 3 byte. So coming to the data format. So this SIGBAR-XC provides the same data format as the standard version of SIG also. Okay. In addition to that, there is a 48 bit floating point data type with the following format. Okay. Means as in standard version of SIG, again integers are represented with the 24 bit binary number. Okay, 2's complement representation is used for negative values. Okay, and the characters are stored using the 8-bit ASCII code. Okay, apart from that, there is a 48-bit floating point data type. Okay, so this is the format. Okay, 48-bit. So the first bit is the sign bit, indicates what the sign of the floating point number. Okay, whether positive or negative. So if S is equal to 0 means this positive value, S is equal to 1 means negative value. And the next 11 bits, okay, is the exponent part. So exponent is an unsigned binary number between 0 and 2047. Okay. And then the next 36 bits is reserved for fraction. What is this fraction? Fraction is interpreted as a value between 0 and 1. So if the exponent has a value e and the fraction has the value f, okay, the absolute value of the floating point number is represented as f star 2 power e minus 1024. Okay. So that is how the floating point number is represented in SIGBAR-XC machine. Okay. Then coming to the instruction formats. in standard version of SIG, we have only 24-bit instruction format. Okay, but whereas SIGFOREX has four formats: format 1, format 2, format 3, format 4. Why? Because the larger memory available on SIGFOREX means that an address will no longer fit into the 15-bit field. Okay, of the standard version of SIG. So thus, the instruction format used on standard version of SIG is not suitable. Okay, so there are two possible options at that time. So either you have to use some form of relative addressing or extend the address field to 20 bits. Okay, so we have used both. Okay, we'll use some form of relative addressing, okay, and also we have extended the address field to 20 bits, and they have formed the instruction formats. These instruction formats: format 1, format 2, format 3, and format 4. So these are the new instruction formats. See here, format 1 is 1 byte. It contains only opcode. Okay, and format 2, it is 2 bytes in length, contains the opcode and the bits results for registers as operands. Okay, so 4 bit for one register, another 4 bit for another register. Okay. So the these formats, that means format 1 and format 2, do not reference memory at all. So if you observe the format, no, they do not reference memory at all. Okay, and so they are used for simple instructions, format 1 and format 2. Okay. And whereas format 3 and format 4, format 3 is 3 bytes and format 4 is 4 bytes. Okay, and of course, they reference memory. Okay, because we have the displacement field here and also the address field. Okay, so what is the format of format 3? So first 6 bits is for opcode, and then we have these flag bits, NIX BPE. Okay, 6 flag bits, and then 12 bits for displacement field to store the address of the operand. And then format 4, 4 bytes, again first 6 bits for opcode, then next 6 bits for flag bits, and then the next 20 bits for address. And see here, in the flag bit, we have a bit E, the flag bit E. Okay, so this bit E distinguishes between format 3 and format 4. If E is equal to 0, that means it is format 3 instruction. And if E is equal to 1, it means that it is a format 4 instruction. Okay. And what are the significance of these flag bits? NIX BPE. Okay, the bit XBP are used to calculate the target address using the relative, direct, and index addressing. Whereas the bits I and N, the flag bits I and N, says how to use the target address. Okay, so bit XBP are used for collecting the target address, whereas bits I and N says how to use the target address. And bit E is used to distinguish between format 3 and format 4. So SIGFOREX addressing modes. These are the possible addressing modes. Okay. See how many addressing modes we have. 6 addressing modes: base relative addressing mode, program counter relative addressing mode, direct addressing mode, index addressing mode, immediate addressing mode, indirect addressing, okay, simple addressing. Okay. How do you indicate the base relative addressing mode? Yeah, it is applicable to format 3. Okay, in format 3, we have these flag bits now, NIX BPE. If B is equal to 1 and P equals to 0, it means that it is a base relative addressing. Okay, then how do you calculate the target address? Target address is equal to displacement plus B. So this displacement, okay, plus B. B means the index register. Target address is equal to displacement plus the content of index register. And this displacement is unsigned integer, which is in this range. Okay, it is between 0 to 4095. Okay, and then program counter relative addressing mode. How to indicate this? If B is equal to 0 and P equals 1, then it is program counter relative addressing, applicable to only format 3. How do you calculate the target address? Displacement plus the content of the program counter. Okay, again, displacement range is in this. 20472 minus 20482 plus 2047. And then the direct addressing, how do you indicate this? If the bit B is set to 0 and P is set to 0 in the instruction, see here, if bit P is set to 0 and B is set to 0 and P is set to 0. Okay, or in format 4, if B is set to 0 and P is set to 0, okay, then it is direct addressing mode. Okay, then target address is simply displacement for format 3, and target address is equal to simply address for format 4 instruction. Okay, so this displacement part and this address part. Then index addressing, how to indicate? By setting x is equal to 1, this x bit. So see here, we have the x bit here. If x bit is set to 1, it is understood.